disasters for bad detection and the opportunity to get input to present here the research activities of our radiochemical group in our university. My name is Fotini Nori, I'm coming from the Department of Chemistry of Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, which is the biggest university in Greece. And the subject of my lecture will be clay minerals and zeolites in radioactive waste management. And of course, I'll give you a short presentation of application of Greek minerals. Particularly, I'm coming from the radiochemical laboratory, which belongs to the laboratory of organic chemistry. So, as you can see here, between the research activities of our radiochemical group, the subject concerning the interaction of radionuclides and heavy metals with natural and synthetic materials, which can be used as solvents, occupies the biggest part of our cells in our laboratory. Of course, we have a lot of work on this subject, on the undergraduate and postgraduate level, and in most of the cases is with collaborations with our colleagues from the geology department. Which is the aim of these studies? Our objective is the application of several materials which can be used as solvents in the environmental technology in order to remove from aqueous solutions different species like actinides and especially uranium thorium, radionuclides as cesium, europium, barium, cobalt, because we are using all these as tracers in order to simulate. I can tell you later what you can do. Strontium, of course, technetium, iodide, and of course some heavy metals and toxic elements like lead, cadmium, mercury, chromium, and arsenic. The materials we have investigated and we have used as solvents are clay minerals and zeolites, both natural and synthetic. So concerning the environmental applications, it is well known that zeolites and clay minerals are perfect materials for this kind of applications because clay minerals are abundant, inexpensive, generally are safe materials for environmental applications like filters, absorbers, and carbon stabilizers due to their unique, we can say, properties, because they combine good properties as large, specific surface area, high porosity, surface charge, and surface functional groups. And here we can see some characteristics of the zeolites. They have absorption potential for alkaline and alkaline earth metals. This is the case of chalcocite and dinoclite. Can be synthesized under high alkaline conditions. That means that they can be stable under long-term conditions. Can be excavated on industrial level and can synthesize on industrial scale. And of course, don't provide any energy source for bacteria. And as a natural product, are safe for the environment. All these reasons can explain that these materials have been used in the isolation of hazardous waste and in the form of inventing buffers in repositories for deep geological disposal or fire of high radioactive waste. Here you can see the total catalyzed capacity of some zeolites in comparison to the clays. Here the cation center capacity is always lower, as it is very common. And here some examples of the application of zeolites in repositories for waste disposal, for surface disposal, and in situ permeable bias. a few words concerning the clay minerals. Clay minerals are hydrous hydrophilic silicates with varying amounts of iron, magnesium, alkali metals, and alkaline earths. You can see here the characteristic structure of a clay mineral in the tetrahedral and the octahedral structure. Okay. Here is the structure examines a Q-type zeolite with the characteristic structure and the cavities, the dimensions of the bones where the exangelical cations are. The zeolites are crystalline, natural or synthetic aluminum silicates materials. They have ordered silicon oxides and aluminum oxides tetrahedrals, and due to the presence of aluminum containing tetrahedra, the zeolites have on their surface a negative charge, and that's why this charge can be counterbalanced by exangelic cations. Of course, all these exangelic cations display the Cass Hodgson properties of the zeolites, as you can see. Here you can see the work production of zeolites, the biggest part belongs to China, and here is the map of Greece. Greece is a small country, but it has a very good production of high quality zeolites from this region, Thrace. Here we have zeolites from the villages Petrodam and Axades, and of course, here you can see the deposits in the village Metaxades in Athos, in Greece, and some applications or methods is made of zeolites in this village. And of course, you have a very good production of clays, mainly bentonite from our islands, especially from Milos and Kimolos. So concerning the environment, everybody knows that the contamination of the environment is very easy, but the decontamination is a very hard, time-consuming, and very expensive business. Here we see some severe environmental contamination, which is connected with, of course, the nuclear reactor accidents, like the case of Chernobyl and Fukushima. The military and civil fuel reprocessing plants, the explosions in nuclear waste storage facilities, and all this can explain the fact that there is a big demand for new technologies in the technology in the waste treatment methods. So up till now, the methods they have been used is membrane separation, ion exchange, chemical precipitation, but among all these methods, sorption has been widely applied for removal of toxic elements and radionuclides because it's very simple, low cost, and provide limitation of waste. Sorption is a physical and chemical process by which one substance becomes attracted to another. We can see some examples here. Here is the case of adsorption. We have molecules attracted to the surface of the face. And in the case of absorption, we have molecules down into the back of the face. In most of the cases, we have both phenomena, and that's why the term sorption is used to characterize the sorption process. Of course, there is another mechanism through the sorption, is ion exchange. We can see that ion exchange is a reversible reaction where the ion from a solution is exchanged with ions into the part of the material, the solvent. You can see here the case of solvent ions. socialize the exchange is only with cations, because I said that chlorides have negative charge on the surface, but there is the possibility after chemical modification to provide to modify the zeolites, and that's why zeolites in place can be used for sorption of anionic species. I'll show you some examples. So, the chemical processes taking place include not only adsorption absorption, but a combination of different mechanisms, like surface sorption. You can see the formation here in the case of adsorption of all the inner sphere complexes. That's why, from the point of view of chemistry, we have to clarify the mechanism in all these cases. We have also absorption and ion exchange, surface precipitation. You can see here. We can have diffusion and formation of solid solution, complexation in most of the cases with carbonate anions, and formation of colloidal or pseudocolloidal systems. When we are studying sorption, the first thing we have to do is to make the sorption isotherms. Which is this isotherms we can quantify the retention or release of a compound, the metal from the sample, from the solution on the surface of the solvent. Many isotherms, type of isotherms, can be used, but the most common are the linear, where we can calculate the distribution coefficient, the Fronin isotherm, which is characterized by this equation, and the Langmuir isotherm, which obeys to this equation and this characteristic, because after a certain concentration, we can see this plateau here for the uptake capacity. And although we are measuring the uptake capacity, that means the quantity of the metal which is absorbed on the surface of the solvent. And here you can see the experimental part we are following through the sorption experiments. We can do also experiments in columns, but in most of the cases we are using batch experiments because are very simple. So we have just to weigh our material, just a small quantity, but not less than 10 milligrams. Then we have to add the solution of the metal, agitation, centrifugation, separation, and then we have to calculate the remaining concentration in the solution, in the distant solution. The techniques we are applying for these measurements is for the measurement of the uptake capacity, nuclear spectroscopic techniques, the gamma and alpha ray spectroscopy, liquid scintillation counting, and in some other cases, ICP, MS, or OS, atomic absorption spectroscopy, and UV visible spectroscopy. You can see here the case of uranium. We have to determine the metal in the solution. For the uranium, most of the cases, we are using UV, using the arsenazole reagent. This is the formula of arsenazole with these rings and these groups, which groups can attack uranium, and we can take this beautiful color, which absorbs at 660 nanometers. In the case of cesium and for other radionuclides where we are using tracers, we have to use gamma spectroscopy. In the case of cesium, we are using the cesium 137 tracer. For the characterization of the materials before and especially after the sorption, we are using a variety of techniques like 7S, TEM, XRD, XRF, XPS, TG. Of course, we have to find and to measure the bed surface area, the zeta potential, and in some cases we are using also nuclear reaction analysis in order to investigate the near surface layers. So here you can see that measurements by macroscopic methods can be done. For example, the investigation of absorbed uptake and absorbed surface charge as a function of the pH. You can see experiments with different concentrations, ionic strength, and so on. Here you can see the determination of the zeta potential, which is the potential where there is no charge on the surface. In this case, you can see that the zero potential value is 0.21, and that means that a pH higher than this value, the surface has negative charge, so it can be used for the sorption of cationic species. In the other case, it has positive value. This is the case of uranium and cesium ions. That means that we have to keep the pH, in most of the cases, we use zero reaction pH, a value higher than 2 in order to have this negative charge on the surface. Of course, as I said, we can modify the surface of zeolites using quaternary amines, and we can dump the charge, and in that case, we can use zeolites after the chemical modification for the sorption of anionic species. Species in the case of uranium, this is very, very important because the anionic species of uranium are everywhere in the environment. And here is the periodic table of the chemical elements with the elements under the radiation. We can see the actinides, thorium, and uranium. Of course, we are investigating europium because europium has similar chemical behavior with the trivalent actinides like americium, curium, and it's of course very difficult to investigate this radionuclides in our laboratory. That's why we are using chemical analogs. The same case is for barium. Barium has the same behavior with radium, strontium. Without the radionuclides, it's easier the situation because in the case of cesium, iodine, you can use tracers, technetium is also radioactive, and of course, we are investigating some toxic elements like chromium and lithium. At this point, I have to say that the environmental chemistry of the actinides is very interesting because the actinide elements, as you can see, many oxidation states and show a complex environmental chemistry. For example, uranium exists in 4 different oxidation states. The most common is the oxidation state 6. Americium and plutonium have also many oxidation states. That means that all these elements have interesting chemistry. The presence of actinides in the environment is also connected to several reasons, like the production and use of fertilizers, nuclear conventional energy production, nuclear weapons. But the transport of actinides depends on the geological environment, the temperature and pressure profiles, the pH of the local waters, the redox potential, and of course the concentration of inorganic, most of the cases carbonates, or organic ligands like cumic and cumic acids. The hydrolysis of actinides plays a determined role in the interaction processes. So, here you can see the fractional diagram of uranium-6 species in active solutions of varying pH. In general, we have to determine and to make the absorption isotherms and after to have modeling using some semi-empirical equations like Frondlin όχι, εάν ρωτήνεται να κρατούσε και σε μισό τέμπι, κοντερευμένοι με μόντελες πολλής πέρας. This is the speciation diagram of uranium, calculated by the computer code VTEC. You can see the fraction of the species in different pH. It's interesting to see that at pH lower than 4.5, uranium exists in cationic form, in this one, uranium ion. In this region, we have the formation of many species, that's why we have to avoid this region in our experiments. And then, in the alkali region, in the presence of atmospheric carbon dioxide, we have the formation of the carbonato anion species of uranium. In this course, uranium exists in most of the local waters of the So, why uranium? Why us? We are studying uranium in our laboratory. Because uranium is a very interesting element, it's connected with the nuclear fuel cycle. There's a very rich chemistry. Here you can see that zeolites have been investigated in the United States repositories for the Yukon Mountain where this was a place. You can see the repository and the zeolite distribution of the sand for the treatment of nuclear waste. And now I give you just a few examples of our work. We can see here the uranium uptake using this diagram. Bentonite from Milos. This is the raw material. At pH 3 is the experiment. You can see the uptake capacity is around 60. And this is in chemical modified in order to use it in alkali region. At pH 9.10.5 with lower sorption capacity. This is the structure of montmorillonite, which is the major constituent of bentonite. Which is the aim of this experiment? Is to find applications for the removal of radium gas from waste. This is the bentonite in chemolysis. Here you can see the uptake of uranium at pH 4 using bentonite again. It's higher in this case because the pH is different. And of course, you can also study what's going on when you have presence of other cationic species in the solution, like sodium or calcium in this case. So you can see that we have lower sorption capacity due to the competition. The case of europium also, the europium without any gas in the solution, the europium in the presence of this is calcium, and of course the europium in the presence of humic acid. Have increased absorption capacity, and you will see why. The first thing we have to do is to investigate the effect of the pH, because we have to find the maximum pH, the pH where we have the maximum absorption capacity. So you can see here that the pH 4, the bentonite exhibits the highest absorption capacity. That means that at this pH should be done all our experiments. And then we have to investigate the effect of the mass of the solvent. So we have used different masses, and we found that this one, the smaller one, is the more effective for the sorption experiments. Before the sorption, scanning the electron microscopy image, uranium, and of course here you can see the FT-IR spectra. This is before the sorption, this is after the sorption of uranium, but you can see some characteristic bands are due to the bonding of uranium with the functional groups of the cells of the zeolite. The cesium uptake of bentonite, you have a very good exchange capacity, but after the presence of other species, like sodium and calcium, we have lower capacity, and in the case of humic acid, in the case of cesium, we have a very low absorption capacity because the sorption mechanism in this case is different. It's mainly ion exchange. In the case of uranium and europium, we have formation of outer and inner shell complexes. So, as chemists, we have to investigate always what is going on and to clarify the mechanism. The case of valium, of course. Here you can see some kinetics. Also, the kinetics demonstrate that the mechanism is different. With the europium, we can see the effect of the temperature. It's completely different than the ethereum. When the temperature is increased, the sorption goes faster. Cesium sorption and valium sorption has almost the same effect. All these experiments can be performed with pH 4 for initial concentration 250 mg per liter ppm. The scan electromicroscopy after the cesium absorption. You can see the surface before, the surface after. We did some EDS experiments, and we saw also the surface, the presence of the cesium on the surface. Here you can see some examples of applications of two types of lights with this structure and these rings, and I mentioned rings. So, another example is the interaction of uranium in aqueous solutions using raw and chemically modified philipside containing TAP. This is the structure of the philipside, the constitution, the crystal of the philipside, the rings, and here you can see the isotopes for the uranium absorption, a different pH, and of course the presence of competitive ions like salt, and the kinetics. And in this case, the kinetics are very, very fast. In 30 minutes, the experiment, the sorption has been terminated. After modification, the same experiments with the uranium in different pH region, alkaline region, and the kinetics. Using kinetics, it's possible to have some thermodynamic data, and we can clarify based on this thermodynamic data the mechanism of the sorption, which is very important for us. And here you can see the examination using CERN. This is the crystal of the philipside after the uranium sorption. You can see that the uranium is on the surface, and this can be seen here in this picture, which is a backscatter image. The bright spots belong to uranium because uranium is on the surface. Another example is the case of the interaction of uranium with sabazite type zeolite. This is the structure of the zeolite, the constitution, and the crystal. In this experiment, it's very important for us to have two crystals in order to compare their behavior with the behavior of the TAP material. And of course, when we have to use, I can show you. Nuclear reaction analysis, we can do experiments only with crystals. So here you can see the uranium octane on superoxide, the different pH. This is pure superoxide, and this is the superoxide. Tough, of course, in this case you have lower pH because it's not pure, like the first pH. And the same images again, the ring. This is the dimension of the formula of the uranium cation, and the backscattered image again with the uranium on the surface, because the dimensions of the uranium ion after the hydration is very big, so it's impossible to go under to the pores of the zeolite. Here you can see the application of nuclear reaction analysis in order to investigate the surface of the zeolite is rapid backscattering using carbon beam in order to investigate the cesium sorption of scoriosite superoxide. This is the case of superoxide. You can see this is the structure, the crystal you have investigated, the dimensions, and this is the ionic radius of cesium. That means that cesium can enter into the bulk, and this can be seen on this spectra, because otherwise we could see here a peak. But this wide spectrum means that cesium is in the bulk of the material. Here you can see the difference, for example, is the case of scoriosite. So you have cesium sorption and strontium sorption. Scoriosite is the structure of the material, the crystal suite used for random scattering spectroscopy. And here we can see that the ionic radius of cesium and strontium is bigger than the dimensions of the zeolite. That means that the sorption is on the surface, and you can see from this big on that. Using this nuclear reaction analysis, it's very easy to find what is going on mere surface layers, just in a few atoms. And this is the advantage of this kind of techniques. But of course, you have to do all these experiments with collaboration with our colleagues in nuclear physics Institute of Photosynthesis. And some other, of course, cases using other crystals. You have investigated a lot of materials in Dimorphos in order to see what is going on the surface. The case of fluorine of pyrapatite, the distribution of fluorine using nuclear reaction analysis, the different gains. And here you can see the surface precipitation using atomic force microscopy after absorption of cobalt on Q-type zeolite. This has been done in our laboratory in the chemistry department. Of course, the ion exchange and absorption of cobalt using random backscattering spectroscopy. Of copper, no comment, comment by the finisher, this is copper. And here you can see also using CEDS, the copper on the surface. Here is the application of zeolites from petrol-tar for uranium removal. You can see the different pH, the uptake capacity for uranium. The kinetics are very, very fast. The oil process is very fast. Of course, the same image of the zeolite from petrol-tar. And in most of the cases, we have this is the pH equilibrium after the sorption, according to the initial concentration, you have to measure always after the sorption the pH, because you would like to know if some cations are released or not the solution, and to see what you have to do to avoid precipitation, because European, this is the critical point. After VH5, it's very difficult to investigate these materials. Here you can see some characteristics of this zeoreactor. The total is a very good one, very good quality, around 90% phenolite. This is the chemical analysis, and this is the application in waste water treatment. This is before and after the addition of the zeoreactor dissolution. And here is our last work concerning the investigation of sabazitic materials to remove cesium from cementitious aqueous solutions. And the objective was to study sabazitic materials in real conditions and to assess the ability, both of course, we used natural synthetic materials to sort and immobilize cesium from young concrete pore water. That means in alkali region, because this material can potentially leach from the cement based barriers and waste. And you can see here at natural pH, the different sample size, the uptake from the cesium, and here at very alkaline pH is almost the same. Here we have a comparison of the values obtained for the cesium uptake from this concrete after 100 days contact time. So we can see that there is no significant difference in the cesium uptake between 14 and 100 days. This is an evidence also and from the genetic experiments we have done. Yes. Here you can see also some synthetic materials we have synthesized in our laboratory. It's sorption of different metals between them, the uranium and europium, for using modified thermal power plant ash in order to have synthetic zeolites, and the comparison of this fly ash, the pure fly ash, the synthesized one, the modified, and these are real bentonite and philipsite, the comparison, and of course one synthetic organic material synthesized in our department, and this one is one inorganic. It's been done to spec with a very high uptake capacity. And of course, the last case is that in recent years, researchers have used zeolites and clays as a substance for support other materials because it's very easy to use, especially in the case of nanoparticles, because in this case, it's very easy to use these particles in column experiments. And of course, the cost is very low in this case. Especially in the case of zero-valent iron nanoparticles, because of agglomeration, and it's difficult to treat the zero-valent iron nanoparticles in the real environment, to support them on cells of bentonite or zeolite, it's very, very important. Here you can see our last work is sorption of thorium using nanoparticles synthesized in our laboratory, and of course, nanoparticles supported on the cells of bentonite. And that's about all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for your work. But you tried to compare the uranium sorption on bentonite and thalite and natural organic photons by coal or heat.
Last time we did this experiment, because till now we did experiments only in aqua solutions with uranium, and then we had to increase the ionic strength using sodium. Now we are using the, as you can see, calcium and humic acid. With humic acid, we have some complexes with uranium. That's why we have increased sorption capacity. But this is the case in the environment because uranium has a very big mobilization. And when it forms all these complexes with organic matter, you should think about this. But we are all these experiments are under investigation in order to see what is going on.
Thank you for very interesting presentation. Are you sure that uranium on surface, when you show in the scanner images by a telescope, is sorption and not the individual phase of nanoparticles?
This one. This one was nanoparticles.
I control this, maybe this precipitation of minerals.
Yes, yes, we have also precipitation. That's why I said at the beginning that in the case of uranium and europium, the sorption mechanism is very complicated, and you cannot say that you have only iron exchange, okay, is the case of cesium in most of the cases. But with uranium, you have formation of most of the cases outer sphere complexes, surface precipitation, and you have also adsorption. So it's a mixed, a complicated mechanism. You are right.
What phase, mineral phase of uranium in this precipitation?
In most of the cases, we found that it's because we did it XRD. I don't have the diagram. So we did XRD. We thought that there is a special uranium compound. It depends, of course, on the pH and on the solvent we are using, but I cannot remember, but maybe I will remember later.
Нужно сказать, что значение 0 здесь по обмену между университетской программе Erasmus, вот, может быть, Наталья, если я что-то скажу, неправильно, это правильно, обмену опыта между преподавателями, между университетами Европы и вот сейчас России. Поэтому, наверное, от нас можно пожелать успехов греческим студентам и нам тоже заодно. Да. Спасибо большое. Сейчас у нас кофе-пауза, дальше, надеюсь, что все будет по программе.